we're thrilled to share the film and its soundtrack with you, with a room full of Coltrane fans.
As far as we know, this is the only film soundtrack that John Coltrane ever recorded.
The film was made in 64. The soundtrack was recorded by John Coltrane and his Classic Quartet at the request of director Gilles Grou. The film is a landmark film for Quebec film history, but strangely enough, it seemed to be kept a secret outside of Quebec. It had too much importance to remain a local secret. So I've been working with the film board and with people at Impulse since the last 5 years to actually make these recordings available to the general public. It deserves to be released as an album. I think that these recordings are important. They put in context Coltrane's evolution as a musician. But back in 64, this was strictly made for the purpose of a soundtrack of a film. Coltrane was essentially revisiting recordings that had been previously released, such as Naima, for instance. So with these recordings from 64, we really get a chance to see how Coltrane's sound was evolving. So the version of Naima from 59 that we can hear on Giant Steps is extremely different than the version of Naima that we can hear in this film. Gelder Studios really used that music in a very intelligent way. It's used in a very sensitive manner. So in the film, we can only hear about 9 or 10 minutes of music. And knowing that at the film board, we had a unique copy of a master tape of studio recordings by John Coltrane, I knew that this should be made available and that this should come out. It was also an unusual choice to go ahead and to ask John Coltrane to record a soundtrack for this film. And for Coltrane to agree to record this soundtrack too was a bit unusual as well. And I feel to use jazz in this context makes a lot of sense because the quartet were at their peak when they recorded this. So this was recorded over a very brief period of time. The session took place on June 24, 1964, between 2 p.m. and 5 p.m. So it's not something that happened over the course of weeks. To be here tonight, to listen to this music in a theater, a great sound system, and then to watch the film is kind of feels like mission accomplished, essentially. Curious, were you, as someone who was a jazz musician, a drummer, someone who's had the chance to play with Coltrane, were you at all familiar with the existence of this film and the existence of this soundtrack?
Not at all. Yeah. Not at all. But hearing the music was what we were listening to in 64, was somewhere between an album called Crescent and Love Supreme. Love Supreme came out in 1965. To hear this, they were playing in the open room, and it was, they had no headphones. There was no, everything was done right there, and they were close enough together. They could hear each other acoustically. There's no monitors.
We can hear, during one of the tracks, we hear some humming. So I think it's McCoy Tyner who gets the zone.
Yeah,
McCoy, and we can hear
Elvin
some humming kind of, over.
Elvin used to grunt all the way through.
Yeah. If you pick up on that, as you said, it's a good thing to mention. It was really recorded live.
It was like hearing them in a club.
I would say the recording, first off, congratulations. It's fantastic. The sound is great, and some of the things that Terry talked about are there right away, and that's just the beautiful sound and the great production of the recording. And it's very reflective of everything that he did in that period. You know, you're talking 1964, and one of the things that caught my ear when I first heard it was how effective and how great the music sounded, but it was like miniatures of those tunes. With the exception of Blue World, everything's like 3 or 4 minutes. And so you hear these three takes of Village Blues, and there's already a vibe before Coltrane comes in. You know, it's like you just hear the rhythm section play one chorus, and the groove is so deep and the sound is so rich, and you know, the beat is like really wide. It's very loose, right?
And a lot of space.
And he plays the head and he plays two choruses, takes it out, but it's classic. It's classic, you know, and it's So they've managed. I mean, the band was so great, and that was such a wonderful time for that group that they've managed to capture everything they did, but in miniature for the film. Like the context is not lost on me, but the music is still fantastic.
The way the music is used in the film, the music only appears during the scenes that take place in Montreal. At one point, there's part of the film that takes place on the countryside, and the music, the soundtrack is completely different. So for GRU, we knew that this was kind of an urban sound and something that was inscribed in a time and place.